Picked up traces of other cores while the kid was out. In better days, the melting pot was sealed tighter than the skin on a squirt. Of all the plans to survive the calamity, it had to be stab weeds. Blasted things hurt like a broken heart. If there's a core, he figures it ought to be deeper down. Core stuck inside one of those fancy cages. No breaking a cage like that, but the kid tries anyway. Gotta find a way to spring it open. Some of the stuff lying around is downright dangerous. He throws a switch. Now what could possibly go wrong? Quite a bit, as it turns out. The cage starts lifting from the core ever so slow. All kid can do is wait. Shipments start falling in. Not every squirt's born bad. Some spring to the kid's defense. Judging by the movement of the cage, it's gonna take a little while. Scumbags don't take kindly to interlopers. Even some gas fellas take his corner. Heard he popped that mean old foreman. At this rate, maybe 5 more minutes, maybe 30, hard to tell. Squirts get real territorial around the core. Then a shipment of free samples shows up. It ain't all bad, as the kid finds some spices from the motherland, tax-free. One thing's for sure, that cage is awful heavy. I still remember the look on his face after that one. The old world's finished, but the new world's just getting started. The windbags used to be all right, then the calamity took the floor out from under him. Folks voyaged across the boundless sea to found Ceylandia. It was good living here for a while. The Bastion's a place of peace, but we can hold our own if we have to. Kid can't handle with hammer and bow in hand. Fetching fizz is like a mouthful of nails, but the benefits are worth it. Windbag Ranch was built for gathering squirt extract in copious supply. Ain't nothing more healthful. folks came to train their throwing arms. Place gets awful slick sometimes. Still others use the place to test their finest blades. Kid cuts all of them down soon enough. Kid comes back from Windbag Ranch smelling good and ripe. Kid packs a special surprise in every one of those arrows. Couples used to walk the sundown path. Kid ain't here for pleasure, though. But then, somebody gets to the core before the kid. The floor starts giving way under the lightest step. A single panic squirt could bring the whole place down. Fragments of the old world rain from the sky. Stray valuables are lying everywhere. Kid thinks twice about risking his hive one, though. Well, the path ain't exactly open to visitors no more. Security's all fired up. See, the path was intended for leisurely strolling and such. Sky bridges link the path together. One of them bridges whips the kid along. Air travel always was an iffy proposition. The calamity changed everything, even where the wind blows. Well, if we mastered the winds in the old days, we can do it again. But the question is, who else could have taken the core? Well, ain't no survivor stole the thing. Scumbag ate it by mistake. Tough break. Unlike the kid, that core ain't coming back. Know they used to ship live munitions down the path. Find time to find them. He's wise to toss those things plenty far away. Even gas fellas need some shut-eye from time to time. They get real cranky when you wake them up. In all this toil, Kid keeps coming back to an overwhelming question. Who else could have survived the calamity? So he didn't find the core that time. But that ain't about to stop us. The dead welcome him with open arms. The calamity took everybody after all. Kid sees it plain, frozen faces all around. He don't much care to see him. Not like this. These folks never saw the calamity coming, but someone did. Someone close. Someone who ain't like Mr. Beckley and his kindly wife. It was someone like him. Kid sees him there agape, in the flesh. It's a snag or two trying to get to him. He ain't about to stop, no matter what. He's got so many questions after all. Just ain't got time for answers. The Tundra brothers didn't make it. They never saw what it was like beyond the walls. Nor did the Bird Boy. Didn't make it. The Jawsons, they didn't make it. Grady Sr., Grady Jr., they didn't make it. But him, he survived. Just think, without that man, we wouldn't be here right now, would we? The Corps survived as well. Kid does what he has to do. And then, what do you say to a man who's seen too much? Kid hasn't a clue, but he says this. We have to go. Please. He's a proper gentleman, that man. His name is Zulf. No hiding, he's an Ura. Folks like him ain't never been a common sight in Ceylandia. He's relieved to see a living face or two, The kid and I introduce ourselves in kind. Both to him and to each other for the first time. For Zolf, Ceylandia was like a second home. He's real worried about his first home, too. Far to the east. We all lost loved ones in the Calamity, he says. I don't know how I'm gonna go on without mine. Sometimes a single look says it all. Kid ain't finished here yet. The cores, they remember. That's why this place is coming together. That's why things are gonna be all right. Well, look what we have here. The lost and found. Here, Kid takes fragments of the old world and makes them whole again. All it takes is some fragments, and the Bastion makes it good as new. Ain't never letting go of his old friend with a sturdy grip like that. We tracked down a couple more cores near the edge of the city. No use praying to the gods these days. No time for it either. Folks used to make pilgrimage here to pay their respects to Pith, the bull. Well, the gods are long gone now, and the Orchard Core is long gone too. Pith stood for something once. Something real. In time, though, the bull stopped being a symbol and started being decoration. Pith makes a decent scarecrow, at least. Then Pith lights up like a rodeo. Kid breaks him to bits. Must have been guarding that shrine. So what'll it be? Invoke the gods, or tell them off? Pith. Kid decides to press his luck. Well, if the gods are alive, they must be plenty sore. Kid kid ain't never seen windbags that quick. Maybe old Pith put a scare in him. Don't care about trinkets, but the kid ain't no god. Zulf's precious shrine. Pith Orchard. Place is a dead end in more ways than one. Now we can build a shrine of our own. Though I got some alternatives in mind. Zulf doesn't touch the thing. Says the god of commotion is no children's toy. The Ura feared the gods. We turned them into toys, put their faces on our walls. There's only one way to cinder brick fort. The hard way. Sure, the city marshals may be gone. But now the fort's crawling with windbags. They've been left to freeze, or starve, or face the kid. Well, windbags young and old keep fighting for the fort.
Huh?
least the marshals left the kid a parting gift. Something the windbags just can't handle. Something that'll punch clean through their greasy hides. Windbags ain't much different from normal folks. All they want's a warm place to stay and a decent meal. A lot of them wound up here in this very fort. Could have been minding the business underground like in the old days. Windbags can't use the martial supplies, but the kid sure can. He stashes the martial's prize, goes back to something more his style. As for the windbags, Cinderbrick gave him enough heat and metal to munch on for a while. Well, the fort ain't theirs by right. Can't blame him for wanting it, though. So many of those sorry things holed up inside that old fort. Kid's stash of grenades is there for him if things get even worse. Secured his plane gone haywire. Windbags gummed up the works. Kid ain't afraid of getting burned. They trap the kid in the middle of the fort's parade grounds. And Glandon and all their scumbag uncles. They got something to gain and only their sorry hides to lose. Kid takes down Glutus. Maybe it was Glandon. The other big fella soon joins his brother, wherever they are now. finally get the message. Kid used to dream of getting a marshal's badge, but not like this. The Skyway's a welcome sight after all that. And now ain't nothing left for nobody down at Cinderbrick Fort. Kid shows up just as Ulf's telling me about his own journey to the city. Zulf's travels ain't much compared to what the kids had to go through for all this. Zulf brought his antique smoking pipe all the way from the terminals. The marshals seemed like good men, he says. They treated him with dignity. Seems the only thing the Calamity saved for Zulf was a smoking pipe. Even since the Urus surrendered to us, the marshals kept a wary eye on him. Behold, the Pantheon. A Kobe. The gods never liked competing for people's affections. Squirt cider will toughen you right up. Too bad about the musty aftertaste. Poor kid collapses after just one drag. The past. Only good thing ever come out of the past is history. Catches up with the kid. Hardly had a moment's rest since all this started. Fair to say he's led a hard life. Supposing what he says in his sleep ain't no lie. He never knew his old man. But he had his mama to take care of. Frail thing with pure white hair like his. Hmm. having his mama's hair did the kid no favors while he was growing up, but he learned to hold his own out there. School ain't working out, so the kid signs up for a turn on the rippling walls. Make his mama some money. Thanks to folks like the kid, the walls kept Ceylandia safe from whatever's out there. The elements, the Ura, you name it. Once the kid done his time, he hurried on home. Turns out his mama's time was done too. The city had nothing for him. The money he'd been sending home was nowhere to be found, neither. So what'd the kid do? Why, he went right on back to the walls for another 5 years. In the history of Ceylandia, nobody's ever volunteered for a second shift on the walls. Out there, kid learned to fend for himself. Learn to build, learn to break. In time, the kid earned good standing with the marshals. They trusted him to scout out farther than anybody. One night, on one of his expeditions, the ground beneath him shuddered, cracked, and split apart. He saw nothing where the world used to be. The calamity happened just like that. All the kid had to work with was his hammer and the clothes on his back. Through twisted streets, he ran with nothing but the city crest and an old stranger's voice to guide him. Finally arrived at Ceylandia's vaunted safe haven, he and no one else. But then, all he got was more thankless work from a man who ain't even asked his name. Sure, I may be the one who dreamt up the walls and the bastion, but the kid made him real, not me. I'd like to say I'll never forget him, or what he's doing, what he's done. I surely would. finders keepers. If you're feeling low, count on the buttery flavor of our own Bastion bourbon. The city's unwanted things all met their end in the yard. Folks who fouled up would do their time here, smashing things to bits. The quicker they worked, the sooner they could go. Folks learned to plant their feet and put their backs into it. Others would plot a course to navigate that sea of junk. Had to work real fast for the finest prize. Ever want to just smash things for a while? You know where to go. A sail hammer's only as strong as its spine. And that's a strong spine. It wasn't fixed, it was unbroken. Zolf offers to help me plot the skyways for the kid. At least the calamity hasn't touched the stars, he says. He was born in the Tazzil terminals. The Ura sent him on a mission of peace to our city, and he's lived here ever since. We could always see the stars, we just never could reach them, no matter how high we built. We fought the Ura decades ago, but that was then. Things are different between us now. The Langston River flowed free and wild till the Calamity drank it all up. Maybe all that water just grew wings and flew off. Riverbanks swarming with windbags. They're so bent on finding the core, they hardly notice the kid. Lucky for him, a certain famous fairy barge is still afloat. Weepin' Nelly. She'll send some squirts crying home as she leaves port. Maybe Nelly knows the way to the core. Maybe she can slip right past all the clamor on the coast. Or maybe not. The security skiff pulls up portside. Nelly's just another windbag to those guns. Just then, the windbags notice who she's sailing with. They're pretty steamed about what happened at Cinderbrick. They try to cut her off. They try to slow her down. They try to knock her out. Well, Weepin' Nelly tries harder. Try as she might, though, she hits a snag. Kid's gotta help her get untangled. Favors for favors. At least she picked a good spot for a break, cause the core is right there. Then the kid hears an unusual sound, like 100 flapping wings. They had their own eyes on the core, but why? Well, kid ain't got time to think it over just yet. He finds a Weepin' Nelly raring to go. Turns out she's got a special surprise for when the waters get rough. She's gonna need a little help with all them peckers. Traffic things think they're king of the roost now. Rest of us only wish we could fly in times like these. Security skiffs keep on coming starboard side. Don't seem to care what they shoot, as long as they hit something. Better idea. They aim to smash Weepin' Nelly to splinters. Well, it all proves too much for poor Nelly. Just gotta make one last stop. With With her last breath, Nelly gets the kid to solid ground. Solid ground in Picker Country. They want that core real bad. Seems a calamity ain't hurt the Pickers' appetites. Kid shoos them off, knowing they'll be back. Know how many times Kid nearly fell off the barge back there? A good couple of times. Now, listen close. You should remember this next part. Why go to Prosper Bluff? Used to take an enterprising man or a plain old fool to venture out that far. The city was the most beautiful place in the world. We all knew that. But on the other hand, some folks just yearn to see the things they're told they can. And that's why you go to Prosper Bluff, ain't it? There, the kid hears something he ain't heard in a long while. How's it go again? Yeah, that's the one. Well, no point explaining what happens next, right? Suffice it to say, kid ain't coming home empty-handed. And besides, it's like the song goes.
I dig my hole, you build a wall.
There'll be here before too long. We darn near celebrated when the kid got back, didn't we? Zolf never thought he'd see a fellow Ura again. We become fast friends. Calamity has that effect on people. But there was more to be done. There was one last core to find. A scientific journal written in Zolf's native tongue. He learned so much from it. Too much. If only I'd known half the secrets of the Calamity were tucked away in that book, I'd have worked to translate it right away. Most of the Ura never got a taste of Ceylandia's fine goods, unless they were born and raised in the city like Zia here. Sure, the world's all gone to pieces farther than the eye can see, but leave it to this gal to point out the amazing view. Girl tried to run away from home one time, but the marshals stopped that, didn't they? So many secrets in there, and she can't even read it. Her father's own journal.